never split up the party. Hey, what's going on, everybody? It's your boy Will, and welcome back to another spoiler review. We are taking a look at episode 7 of The Legend of Vox Machina, entitled The Fae Realm. This is a spoiler review, so if you have not checked out the newest episode yet, make sure you pause this video, go check it out, and then come back and hear my thoughts on it, because it's like all these episodes, it's really good, and it's got one hell of a trip, too. And if this happens to be your first time checking out one of my videos, thank you for checking this out. Again, my name is Will, and I do geeky stuff on the internet. I do reviews, reactions, discussions, some gaming, some drinking. Usually just like to have a lot of fun, and I hope you do as well. And if that happens to be your bag and you're interested in hearing my opinion from a geeky bear like myself, subscribe to the channel. It would really help this channel out, and I would really appreciate it very much so. So let's talk about episode 7, entitled The Fae Realm. So this episode does pick up with the immediate aftermath of what happened in episode 6 with the escape from Kamal Giari's lair and the battle with Umbrasil. Vox Machina, they barely escaped the attack from Umbrasil, especially with a wounded pike at the hands of her best buddy, Scrog. Unfortunately, the spell was interrupted because of Umbrasil's attack, so Keyleth, Vax, Vex, and Percy were transported to the Fae Realm, while Grog, Scanlan, and a wounded pike were sent somewhere in Tal'Dorei. We pick up with our crew in the Fae Realm, and we actually find out Percy hugely obsessed with the Fae Realm and all the books that he got to read when he was younger. So he's just living it up while he's trying to help the crew navigate and try to take the lead on this and be helpful for a change. We also see there's still a little bit of tension between Percy and Vax, obviously because of what happened with Vex, but they are in the Fae Realm based off of the vision that Scanlan got through Mythcarver to look for the Fentress Bow, which is one of the vestiges of Divergence that they need in order to slay the dragons. Now, while they're making their way through the Fae Realm, they do encounter a satyr named Garmalie. Again, if I butcher any names, sorry, but he is just whimsical and is happy to see some new faces in the Fae Realm and is an artist, and he likes to draw dicks. This becomes important if you're a fan of Campaign 2. He offers his services, but Percy is not obliged to take it while he feels confident he can lead the team through the Feywild. But eventually he does need to rely a little bit on Garmalie, mainly because of some of the encounters with the creatures of the Fae Realm that they have to go up against. And there's a drug trip mixed in there as well, which is really hilarious, based off of one of the attacks of like a goo creature that goes after the crew, mainly going after Vaxildan. And a lot of the Fae Realm is not happy with his mere presence in the Fae Realm, mainly because of the Deathwalker's Ward vestige that he now is in possession of. While all this craziness is going on, especially with a drug trip and an actual talking version of Trinket, voiced by Cheech Marin, which is a really fun fact, we go back to Tal'Dorei with Grog, Scanlan, and Pike. While Pike is trying to recover from her injury, she's trying to heal herself, but Craven's Edge is way too close and starts sopping up some of the blood that she's losing, which puts Grog in a very uncomfortable position, being that he is responsible for what just happened to Pike, but his obsession or the hold that Craven's Edge has on him is starting to become a little too great, almost to the point where he attacks them again. But Grog is able to snap out of it and able to fight the urges enough to destroy Craven's Edge, but Craven's Edge does not go quietly into that night. He ends up cursing Grog, I'm assuming it's a curse or something, where he basically saps all of his strength, leaving Grog as a very tall, very lanky barbarian, and completely weak on top of all of that. It's a sad fate for our favorite head chopper, but this is what happens when you make a bargain with a sword that can suck people's blood. It's not all doom and gloom, because Pike is able to recover to a certain extent, and they head off through Tal'Dorei in order to try to get Grog some help for his affliction. And we get to see a more kinder, caring version of Scanlan as he is helping his friend Grog through this, to the amazement of Pike, and we start to see a little bit more of the seeds of their potential relationship, which again, Scanlan kind of flubs it a little bit, but it doesn't seem like it's a big thing because Pike is still very smitten by his ability to be caring and be helpful and not necessarily always be crass and crude. And this is a callback to his conversation with Kamal Jiori. We're talking about how he wants love, but he always kind of seems to mess it up. And this leads into a very wonderful song that's a duo between Scanlan and Pike as they're making their way through Tal Dorei to get to their destination. The song is called Making My Way, which if you've never watched the live stream, it's kind of a running gag where they reference the song A Thousand Miles by Vanessa Carlson.
I think we're making our way.
Downtown?
And I need you, and I miss you, and now I wonder.
It's a really subtle nod to a long-running joke from the live streams to be incorporated in a different way in the show. Just as a little interlude, we get to see them trying to traverse the dangers of Tal Dorei while taking their friend Grog to get some help. With all of that sort of journeying going on back in the Feywild, we eventually do get an intense encounter with the goo creature and Vax and Percy while leaving Vex and Keyleth on their drug trip, hopefully someplace safe. He goes to back up Vex, which again, still very brooding, very off, you know, standoffish when it comes to Percy. But he kind of gives a little bit of insight as to why, and he opens up to Percy a little bit about the effects that the Vestige is having, the visions that he sees, and that how he feels like his path is diverting from everyone else's. So that kind of has an effect on his personality, but he does thank Percy for the assist. And we get to see Percy use a new trick that he uses in relation with the piece of residuum that's inside of his palm. If you remember at the end of season one, he had to blow a hole in his hand to exile Orthax from his body, and he ended up replacing it with a prosthetic for, like, I guess a finger that he might have lost, but also to a piece of residuum's in there, and he uses it kind of like almost like a taser to deliver like an electrical shock. And it's a cool way they take down like the goo creature. I'm just gonna say the goo creature because that's the only thing I can think of. But yeah, that conversation was really kind of long awaited, and I don't think it completely squashes the beef, but it squashes the initial tension that seemed to have been lingering over the last like 3 or 4 episodes, which is a good thing. And with all the encounters and the trials that they were going through with the Feywild, they accept Garmalie's help in order to get to the Shade Muck to locate the Fentress Bow. But unfortunately, they encounter a city as they are making their way to the Shade Muck that they have to traverse through in order to reach it. And the city is very familiar to Vex and Vax because it is Singorn, the city that they grew up in with their very abusive, very negative father. And that's where the episode actually ends. We see that they have to go to a family reunion with their abusive dad. That's gonna go over great. That's episode 7 with their trip through the Fey Realm, and or continued trip, because obviously this will take place in episode 8 as well. It's kind of a slower paced episode to most of the episodes that we've gotten up to this point. It had to deal with a lot of fallout from what happened over the course of the last 3 episodes, which were very heavily action-packed and very fast-paced episodes. So it was kind of cool and kind of nice to slow it down just a little bit. I liked the brief interlude that we got with the drug trip that Vex and Keyleth went through, which was really fun. It was cool that they got Cheech Marin to do the voice of Trinket in their drugged state. And it's the way they use the colors in the animation, which was really fun. I like that Percy is trying to find a stronger purpose within the group and can be there for the others in the group the way that they were there for him in season one. So I really enjoy that. The depiction of the Feywild was really cool, and I like how we're traversing more of the realms and how they're giving each one their own personality and unique art style. I really enjoy that. It still had a lot of meat and a lot of character development and a nice little calming palette before we get through to the other, I guess, excitement we should expect for the last few episodes of the season. So every time you have a heavy action focused series, it is nice to have the quiet moments or the slower pace moments in order to kind of catch a breath. They're obviously going for different vestiges because two vestiges were revealed from Mythcarver. So it's fitting that you do have one team going for one and one going for the other. I really don't think we're going to see the conclusion of this entire arc in this season. I'm just guessing based off of everything that we're at to in this point. One other thing too that we did see, we did have a little bit of a follow-up after Umbrasyl was able to run off Vox Machina to a certain extent. He has a conversation with Thordak about the vestiges. And Thordak initially wants nothing to do with the vestiges. He just wants his hoard. He wants his gold. And he kind of scolds Umbrasyl a little bit, but then allows Umbrasyl to continue with his hunt for the vestiges, but not to let up on delivering his payment to the Conclave. And we do see that Umbrasyl and Ripley have a official partnership, and not only to find the other vestiges, but also to just continue to assert the Chroma Conclave's rule over Tal'Dorei at this point in time. It's a solid episode. It's not necessarily my favorite, but it's definitely one that allows for a lot more time for the characters to kind of to address some of the elephants in the room, like the Deathwalker's Ward and the effect it's having on Vax, the tension between Vax and Percy, now with them having to go visit the family in the Fae Realm, that sort of tension, because we know the history, at least briefly, of what happened between the twins and their father. We saw it in the flashback in episode 3. Let me know anything from this episode that I might have missed, anything that you that kind of piqued your interest in the comments down below. Let me know what you thought of Making My Way. I thought it was a cute song. It's not my favorite song. I still think the song he sung to Kamal Giori is still my favorite of the season. So, but, you know, let me know all those things in the comments down below. That is going to do it for this episode review for episode 7, The Fae Realm. Thank you for checking out this video. I really do appreciate it. If you're new here and you did enjoy this video, please subscribe to the channel. It really helped me out. You can check out any of my past reviews for The Legend of Vox Machina, the first 6 episodes of this season, as well as season 1. If you want to catch up on those, feel free to check those out. You can check out a lot of other videos I have on the channel, because I have a bunch of them. So please check those out. I really, really appreciate it. You can follow me at a lot of different social media platforms listed at the end of this video. Like, share, subscribe, all that fun stuff. And as always, until next time, I will catch you later. Hey, thanks for watching this video. If you did like this video, why not give me a thumbs up and share it with your friends? You can subscribe to the channel by clicking on my gorgeous little face right over there. You can follow me on all the various social media platforms right below. And last but certainly not least, if you've got a few extra minutes, why not check out one of the lovely videos floating right over here. Later.